today in Galatians because it answers a question a lot of people have. In fact, probably one of the most common questions that I've heard from folks in the last 40 years of ministry comes in the form of a warning as well, and that is this: how do you get right with God? You hear that warning, you know, especially in times of trouble or times where there's a threat of some sort. You better get right with God. You need to be right with God. Well, how do you get right with God? See, I'm not just content to, never have been just content to hear somebody tell me I need to do something. What I want to know is how to do it. Not just what to do. I want to know how to do it. Now, how many of you know it's a lot easier to tell people what to do than it is how to do it? It's a lot easier for us. A lot quicker, a lot simpler. But this common question was plaguing the churches of Galatia in a very dramatic way. And this question continues to plague people today. How do we get right with God? Now, if you ask that question in certain religious circles, they're going to break out a list of rules and regulations that you're going to have to follow to get right with God. And, of course, invariably all of them base those rules and regulations on their interpretation of the Scriptures or what the Bible says. The Bible says you ought to do this, that, or the other. And the Bible says you ought to quit doing this, that, or the other, and then you'll get right with God. But actually, that's not what the Bible says. Unfortunately, they've misinterpreted it. So what I want to share with you today is what Paul, in writing to the churches of Galatia, of the region of Galatia, told them about what it takes to get right with God. In our terminology, what does it take to win God's favor? What does it take to get His approval? Now, this is real important. Inasmuch as we recognize that every good gift comes from God, inasmuch as we recognize that in Him we live and meet and act and behave and have our very being, we live and move and have our very being, our very life, it's because of God that we continue to breathe and our heart continues to beat. And so I don't know anybody that doesn't want to be right with God. The question is, how do you do that? How do you get right with God? Well, to break you into the context here a little bit of what we've been studying in Galatians, there were a set of men, certain teachers, that were known as Judaizers. These guys were Pharisees. You remember the Pharisees? They were the ones that wanted to crucify Jesus, most of them. But there were a few of them, like Nicodemus, like Joseph of Arimathea, who actually trusted Jesus as the Messiah. They actually accepted Him when the whole nation as a whole rejected Him. These men actually accepted Jesus as being their Messiah. And they believed that when He died on that old rugged cross they just sang about, when He died on that cross, He died for their sins to win God's approval for them. They actually believe that. But then, because of their conditioning, because of the way they had been raised, because of their background of Judaism, they fell right back to trying to live out their life as a Christian, in our terminology today, this new life that they got. They fell right back into the old ways of thinking about what it takes to get right with God. And they insisted that in order for a Christian, one who's born again, to be right with God, they had to first of all engage in a ritual that they considered to be absolutely vital, because it's the only ritual that separated, religious ritual that separated the Jewish nation from all others. They considered the rite of circumcision to be absolutely essential. That you could not be right with God unless you were circumcised and kept the law of Moses. And what's the law of Moses? Well, you all know it as the Ten Commandments. If you want to be right with God, you got to keep those Ten Commandments, which most of us would be hard-pressed to do, in as much as we can't even remember the Ten Commandments, much less keep them. But they said you've got to keep not only the Ten Commandments, but all the statutes, the ordinances, judgments associated with those Ten Commandments given in the first five books of the Bible called the Pentateuch, or the Law, that prescribed in detail how you should act, how you should live your life to keep the Ten Commandments for the Jews. Now, Paul, being a Pharisee himself, knew all about that conditioning. In fact, from his own personal testimony given to us in the first two chapters of this letter to Galatians, he gives his own personal testimony, and he explains how that he himself had an experience with the risen Savior, Jesus, on the road to Damascus, and that he himself became a believer. But at the close of his personal testimony, he gave us a little insight into the gospel, the good news he was teaching these Galatians, and that is, he said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, that is in this body, with the presence of sin and flesh in it, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Finally, he said, I don't frustrate the grace of God. I don't make the grace of God of no effect. For if righteousness comes by works of the law, then Jesus died for nothing. Now, that's a pretty strong statement. It's a little nutshell that we studied here several month or two ago in detail. But I just want to remind you that the message Paul was preaching to the Galatians, the true gospel of grace, concerned how one got right with God by exercising your faith, not by doing religious things. And so he's contrasting here two different lifestyles that we've got to come to grips with. Two different lifestyles. We're going to decide which one we're going to live in on a daily basis. The first and natural lifestyle, not only for Paul and all the other Pharisees, but for all of us as well, is a lifestyle of law, that is, rules and regulations, and lies, deceiving ourselves and faking it with others. That's a normal lifestyle. That's a lifestyle we've all been conditioned and raised up in. That's a lonely lifestyle we really know. And you don't even have to think about living that kind of lifestyle. You just do it naturally. The first characteristic of that lifestyle of law and lies is you've got this obsession with trying to figure out the rules. What's right and what's wrong. You've got to know the difference between good and evil. Else how are you going to do what's good and not do what's wrong? So we get this obsession in our minds naturally with what's right and wrong. And we get the idea that if we can figure out what's right, then we can get right with God if we do it. But then if we figure out what's wrong and we quit doing it, we can get right with God. So how we get right with God is to A, know the rules and regulations, and B, follow them. Sounds pretty simple, doesn't it? Pretty natural. The only problem with that is it doesn't work. Actually, following that lifestyle of law and lies doesn't get you right with God. What it does is it makes God mad. Did you know that? Yeah, it makes him mad. He's not pleased with that. It irritates him and grieves him when we live that kind of lifestyle. Because the lifestyle he has in mind for us was a lifestyle that was exemplified by his son Jesus. And in that contrast that John gives us in this first chapter of his gospel, he says, the law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus. And he introduces us there to a brand new lifestyle, a lifestyle of grace and truth, as opposed to a lifestyle of law and lies. If we're going to get right with God, we're going to have to learn about this new lifestyle of grace and truth. We're going to have to enter this new lifestyle of grace and truth. We're going to have to follow the example that Jesus gave of a new lifestyle altogether. Not one that we're naturally acquainted with, not one that we just kind of roll over after we're born again and go on trying to live our lives now that we're a Christian like we used to live up to this point, but a brand new lifestyle, a lifestyle of grace and truth. Now, unfortunately, not many people, even yet today, have come to grips with that new lifestyle. American Christianity today is especially perverted, thinking that the way that we ought to live is that same old lifestyle of law and lies. And all they do is they give it a religious coat and say, now that you're a Christian, these are the things you need to start doing to get right with God. And now that you're a Christian, these are the things you better quit doing to be right with God. And they focus their attention purely on what's right and wrong with the assumption that if they can know what's right, they can do it. And if they can know what's wrong, they can quit doing it. Again, there's one fundamental problem with that, isn't there? You already know more right than you can do. You already know more right. And you already know more wrong than you can quit doing. You already know it. It's not a matter of learning something new. And when you're honest with yourself and with God, you realize the very purpose that God gave the law, the very purpose he gave Moses, the Ten Commandments, the very purpose he gave him all those statutes and ordinances, the very purpose he gave the law to the world through Israel is to prove that the whole world is guilty and in need of a Savior. It was never intended to be a means of salvation by which you're going to get right with God. Ever. The whole Old Testament history is about one nation. The great nation we talked about here in chapter 3 that Paul revealed, going back to the example of Abraham, the nation of Israel. It began with Father Abraham. And God chose him, and by his grace, he promised him, I'm going to make a great nation out of you. I'm going to bless them that bless you and curse them that curse you. I'm going to give you all of this land, the land of Palestine, and in your seed shall all families of the earth be blessed. Only problem was, Abraham didn't even have one child. He didn't have one. Even though God promised him, you're not going to be able to number your descendants are going to be like the stars of heaven or like the sand of the sea. You're not going to be able to count how many we got. Well, Abraham didn't have one kid. His wife was barren. But Abraham believed God. He trusted God's promise. And because of that faith, in spite of the overwhelming evidence to the contrary, that faith, God made Abraham right with him. God justified Abraham because he trusted him. What does that tell us? You want to get right with God? Trust him. There's only one way to get right with God. And that's not by what you do or don't do. It's what you believe. Whether you're taking God at his word or not. See, God doesn't need you to do anything. What he wants is you to trust him. What he wants is for you to trust what he's done for you that you couldn't do for yourself. And that's the example of Abraham that Paul's given us right here in chapter 3 of Galatians. Now, Abraham exemplifies a lifestyle of grace and truth in this way. He trusted that God was going to do for him what he couldn't possibly do for himself. And because he trusted that, he lived supernaturally this lifestyle of grace and truth and was later called the friend of God. You want to be friends with God? Trust him. So the emphasis that Paul makes right here in the first part of chapter 3 in his first argument is that we don't live our life to get right with God by a set of rules and regulations, by what we do or don't do. That's not how we get right with God. He calls that the works of the law, by the way. He says that doesn't work. To be right with God, to please God, we can only do that by the hearing of faith. That's Paul's term in Galatians 3 for a lifestyle of grace and truth. The hearing of faith. Now let's see how it's applied here in a little more, a little deeper. In our last study, we went down to the fact that Abraham believed God and he was blessed of God. And so anyone who believes God, like Abraham believes God, is going to be a descendant, spiritual descendant, or child of Abraham, and therefore blessed with God. But in verse 10, he gets a little more precise about that, and I want to finish up our study in this particular argument here today by looking at verses 10 through 14. Listen while I read them to you. Paul says, "For as many as are of the works of the law," these are people that are trying to behave themselves. They're trying to figure out what God demanded in the law and live according to that. They're trying to be good to get right with God. They're trying to quit doing what's wrong to get right with God. They are of the works of the law. "For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse." You see what that's saying? Do you hear that? You go ahead, try to be as good as you can to get God to bless you. You're under the curse. And he explains why in this very same verse. He says, "For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them." Now, in order to understand that, I know that's a little King James mouthful here, but in order to understand that, what it says is this. You can try as hard as you want to be a good Christian. You can try as hard as you want to do what's right and not do what's wrong, and to get God to bless you because of that. You can try as hard as you want to, but you are cursed. You will never get it done. And the reason you'll never get it done is God does not just want you to try hard. See, don't get this idea in your mind that all God wants is for you to do the best you can. I've heard this over and over again for the last 40 years. Well, you know, all God really expects is for us to just try to do the best we can. He knows we're not perfect. We're humans. And so he just wants us to do the best we can in our good intentions to do what's right and not do what's wrong. God will accept. And he'll bless us for those. No, he won't. You're cursed. Your good intentions don't mean anything. Not as far as God is concerned. Why? Because his standard for humanity is that you are exactly like Christ. See, here's his standard, Christ. That's what a normal, healthy, functional human being should look like. Jesus. And here's the rest of us down here somewhere. We're not even close. And even though we might say to ourselves, okay, from now on, I'm going to quit doing this stuff. It's not like Christ. From now on, I'm going to quit being selfish and self-centered. From now on, I'm going to think about other people. And we were able to turn over this magic new leaf in our life. And from now on, we were not selfish and we did start thinking about others. We've still missed it. You know why? Because Jesus never was selfish. He always thought of other people. Jesus never did sin. It's not just that he woke up one day and said, okay, from now on, I'm not going to sin anymore. I'm going to turn over a new leaf and behave myself. Jesus never sinned. That's God's demand. That's his righteousness. The righteousness, not that he just decided one day not to sin anymore, and he made it, but that he never did sin. Do you guys see how late it is for us? It's too late. It's too late for us to try to behave ourselves to get God to bless us. Why? Because we've done screwed up. That's why. You've already blown it before you even know enough about God to know what he demands. Before you're even aware of his commandments, you've already blown it. You were born blowing it. You were born selfish and self-centered, thinking only about yourself. You can never meet that standard that God expects on your own. That's why he says, as many as of works of the law, as many people are trying to behave themselves and get God to bless them, they are cursed. Because the curse comes upon all and any who do not do everything the law demands. In fact, James elaborated on that for us in his little letter. He said that if you offend the law in one little point, you can do everything, all the big stuff, but one little point, say you tell one little white lie, then you're guilty of the entire law. See, God doesn't play this game of big and little sins. He never has. It's all or nothing. You either are righteous or you are not righteous. Your self-righteousness, he doesn't even consider. And when you try hard to be good, you try not to sin, you try to do what's right and not do what's wrong, the only kind of righteousness you've got is your self-righteousness. Same kind of righteousness the Pharisees had. And Jesus said, except your righteousness exceed that of the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll not get into the kingdom. Why? Because you're cursed. See, all men by nature, all human beings by nature are cursed. They're under the curse of the law. Now, why did God do that to us? Why did he allow us to be born under the curse of the law? Why did he give us the law in the first place if he knew we weren't going to be able to keep it? He gave us the law to prove to us that we couldn't keep it. He doesn't mean to offend your little old human pride. He means to shatter it. And if you think there's anything you can do to get God to like you or love you, then you have made Christ of none effect. Christ died for nothing. Now, he doesn't stop there though, which I'm glad, because that's kind of negative. Read on with me. In verse 11, he goes on to say, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it's evident, for the just shall live by faith. I like this. Paul knew, hands down, it's absolutely evident that nobody can keep the law. Nobody can justify themselves by their own efforts to do what's right and not do what's wrong. Nobody can reach that standard of perfection that God demands. See, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus laid it out for him. Chapter 5, verse 48 of Matthew, you be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. That's the standard, and nobody can do it. It's evident that nobody can do it. But then he gives us that hope, that light of the gospel, when he says, the just, those who are declared righteous, that's the just, those who are justified, which means to be declared righteous, shall keep on living by faith. See, our life is not a matter of our effort to do what's right and not do what's wrong. Our lives is a matter of our trusting God to do for us what we couldn't do for ourselves. That's how we continue to live. In quoting Habakkuk, the Old Testament prophet, Paul proves that by saying the just shall live by faith. Now in verse 12, he goes on to carry it a step further, and he says the law is not of faith. That's obvious. You can't be trusting God to do for yourself what you can't do for yourself, and trusting yourself to keep the law. You can't do it. The two are mutually exclusive. The law is not of faith. But the man that does it shall live in him. He's quoting an Old Testament passage from Deuteronomy, the law, when he says, if you were able to keep the commandments of God, then you would live by your own effort to keep the commandments. You can live in it. Problem is, nobody can keep the commandments. Nothing wrong with the commandments. We just aren't able to keep them. And it gets down to the nitty-gritty here in verse 13, when he says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Now, he proved back there in verse 10 that we're under the curse of the law. But now he says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Now, I know it's negative to talk about being cursed. And I know we've got to come to grips with that, because if we try to behave ourselves, to live a good life, to be a good Christian, all we're going to get is the curse of God, because we can't do it. So Paul now focuses our attention on what God has done for us that we couldn't do for ourselves. He announces boldly and point blank. He says, here's what God's done for you. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Every one of us are cursed, naturally. Everyone, the whole world is guilty before God. The law proves that beyond a shadow of a doubt. So what God does for us, we couldn't do for ourselves, is called redemption. He redeems us. Now that word redeemed is a very specific term the Bible uses. It really means to buy out. If you're going to buy out somebody, you're going to pay the price to get them out of your life, to get them out of your business, to get them out of messing with you. You buy them out. It also has a nuance of to buy back or to purchase that which you had lost in the case of a pawn shop. When you go to a pawn shop and you pawn a certain item, they give you a little redemption ticket. And if you go back and pay them back the money, a little more than what they gave you, you can buy back your item. Well, Paul explicitly uses this word, redeem, so we understand that what Jesus did on the cross was to buy us back. What he did on the cross was to pay the price to make us what God expected us to be in the first place. You see, his expectation for humanity is to be just like Jesus. And because of Adam and his fall, no human being is born naturally just like Jesus, and no human being can keep the law good enough to be just like Jesus. So Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. We were cursed, but he has redeemed us from the curse of the law. How did he do that? By becoming a curse for us. Now, what Paul is talking about here in just a few words, becoming a curse for us, it would take volumes to really understand. But to help you with that, I'm just going to give you a little bit of an understanding of what Paul says in Romans chapter 8 concerning this. He said that what you couldn't do, what the law could not do, demanding that you be perfect, because you've already blown it, you ain't perfect, and you never will be on your own. What the law couldn't do, God did. God did for you what the law couldn't do, what you couldn't do for yourself. Well, what did he do? And how did he do it? He goes on to explain in Romans chapter 8, verse 3, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son, Christ, Jesus, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, looking like us, being a human, in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, because of sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. This is what God did to make you just like Jesus. This is what God did by his grace to raise you up to meet his standards. He doesn't lower his standards to match your dysfunction. He raises you up to meet his standards. How did he do that? He sent his son Jesus, who became a curse for us. For it's written, everyone that hangs on a tree, that cross, is cursed. So Jesus became a curse for us. How did he do that? Well, he tells us right there in Romans 8. Historically, over 2,000 years ago, Jesus offered himself a sacrifice on the cross. He hung on the tree. What does that mean? It means that had you been there, had you been able to witness that, from 12 noon to 3 in the afternoon, normally the brightest part of the day, the whole world was engulfed in absolute darkness. Couldn't see your hand in front of your face. Why? During that 3-hour period from 12 noon to 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the light of the world, Jesus, the Son of God, became sin for us. As Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:21, he who knew no sin, that's Jesus, was made sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He became a curse for us. And as a result, God poured out his righteous wrath against all sin in the flesh on Jesus in those 3 hours. Jesus experienced eternal death for every human being, for all of humanity. Now, had you been there, Isaiah gives us a little insight to that. Had you been there at the cross, at the foot of the cross, and somehow magically you had your little flashlight, and you turned that flashlight on and you shined it up there on the cross to look at Jesus, you would not have been able to recognize him as a human being. He became sin for us. And all of God's wrath against sin in the flesh was poured out on him. Why? Why did God do that? For this reason. That we, who fall short of the glory of God, might be made the righteousness of the law in him. That we might meet his standards. Now, I always struggled with that because I thought, you know, it's not really fair. I tried to use an illustration one time that would kind of help me understand it and help other people understand what God did when Jesus became a curse for us. And so I thought of the most hideous kind of criminal I could think of. And it's a guy that, you know, he breaks into your house and he kills your family and he steals all your stuff. And the cops catch him before you do. And they arrest him. They put him in jail. He goes to trial, and a jury of his own peers finds him, according to the evidence, guilty and deserving of death. But when it comes time for his sentencing, the judge says, you know, I know this guy is guilty, but I love him so much, I'm just going to let him go, okay? What? You're going to let this guy go? He's guilty. He deserves death. You can't let this guy go. We would be highly offended. Why? Because it's not fair. It's not fair that the judge should just let this guy go. So the judge says, okay, I understand. Ain't fair. So I tell you what, he deserves death. I tell you what I'm going to do. this is my son, my only son. He's never killed anybody. He's never committed a crime. I'm going to have him die instead of this guy, okay? We'd still think it's not fair. In the back of our minds, we would say, it ain't fair. It ain't fair that this innocent son of the judge should die for this guy who's guilty, this scumbag who killed my family and ripped me off. That ain't fair either. That's why most people have trouble really accepting the gospel. Because they know deep down inside, it ain't fair. Deep down inside, that's not right. That's not fair. To let that innocent one die a horrible death for one who's guilty. That's not fair. And so we have a tendency to reject the gospel altogether. And say, oh, no, no. But let's follow through with that silly example. What will make us accept the gospel? That the innocent one died for the ungodly. What will make us accept that gospel? Even if it's talking about us. And know it's fair. What if the judge said, okay, I realize, I understand you're having a trouble now believing it's fair, even though my son, who's done nothing wrong, is going to die for this person to set him free. So let me give you the rest of the story. Let me tell you the other half of the good news. When my son dies on that cross, this vile scum of the earth murderer is going to die with him. When my son is buried, that sucker is going to be buried with him. And when I raise my son up from the dead, I'm going to raise that murderer, a brand new person that never has sinned. Now, is that fair? That's exactly what God has done for you. You are no longer the same person you thought you were. Because when Jesus came up from the grave, he raised you up a brand new person that meets the righteous standards of God. The question is whether you're going to believe it or not. It's not a question as to whether it happened. The Bible's full of it. It happened. It can prove it. Chapter and verse after chapter and verse. That's happened to you. You were crucified with Christ, buried with him, and a brand new person was raised up, created in Christ Jesus, that is holy and without blame before God in love. That's you. Now the question is, are you going to believe it? Nah, that can't be me, man. Look at that. I'm still living the same old body. Nothing happened to my body. I got born again, went and looked in the mirror, and still the same old mugshot. Nothing happened to me. Oh, I felt a little better inside, but that's all that happened to me. No, that's not all that happened to you. You became one with Christ. You became a new person that meets the standards that God set for humanity. You became righteous. The righteousness of God was given to you freely. By his grace, God did for you what you couldn't possibly do for yourself. So Paul concludes this, saying that Jesus was made a curse for us, that we might receive the blessing, singular. Now, I want you to note this, it's a little fine point. He doesn't say receive the blessings, plural. Which blessings would include making a great nation out of them, blessing those that bless them, so on, giving them the land, blessing all families there, etc. He said that we might receive the blessing, singular. What is that blessing, singular, of Abraham? What's he talking about? He's talking about the fact that God did for Abraham what he couldn't do for himself by his amazing grace. That's the blessing of Abraham, a covenant of grace. That we might receive the blessing of Abraham. You folks have received the blessing of Abraham. You've received the grace of God that has made you one with Christ already. You've received it when you believed on Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. He gives us a real practical application of it in the last verse, verse 14. He said that the promise of the Spirit might come on us who believe. What's the promise of the Spirit? That's the promise Jesus gave his worried, freaked out disciples on the night before he was crucified when he said, I'm leaving you. Where I'm going, you can't come, and I want you to stay here, and I want you to love each other. And they freaked. They lost it. So he said, all right. I know that's a hard thing for you to understand, so I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm not going to leave you like orphans. I will come myself to you through the person of the Spirit of Truth. He'll be a comforter to you. He will comfort you. He'll not just be with you, he will be in you. This brand new person God has made you to be, this brand new person is created in Christ Jesus, holy and without blame, is now indwelled with the same Spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead. That Spirit is now living in you. What's that Spirit there for? To do for you what you can't do for yourself. That Spirit's there to lead you, to guide you into all truth, to teach you, and to remind you of stuff you know. That Spirit is there to empower you to live out a brand new life, the lifestyle of grace and truth. That Spirit is there so that you, as a child of God, can walk in grace and truth as opposed to the law and lies. Well, what's it going to take for you to walk in that way? Same thing it took for Abraham. You're going to believe God. You're going to believe he made you a brand new person. And you're going to believe his Spirit is telling you what he wants you to do today to love other people as you, just like Christ. When you exercise that faith, that simple little teeny tiny bit of faith, you enter into this grace wherein we stand. You enter into a brand new lifestyle as a believer. It's no longer what's right or what's wrong. That is not the fundamental question anymore. As a believer, you don't wonder, well, is this good or evil? Is this right or wrong? And then try as hard as you can to do what's right and not do what's wrong. That's the old lifestyle. That's the lifestyle of law and lies. Here's a new lifestyle for you, a lifestyle of grace and truth. See, God's grace is not just mercy where he doesn't punish you. God's grace is a supernatural working of his Spirit inside of you to conform you to the very image of Christ, to make you think like Jesus, to make you feel like Jesus, to make you act like Jesus, to talk like Jesus, to walk like Jesus right now in this life. That is your new calling. That is your new lifestyle. It has nothing to do with what you're going to think up that you need to do. It has everything to do with what God is telling you. So our new question is not, okay, what's right or wrong? Let me figure out what's right or wrong. No, our new question is, Lord, what do you want me to do? That's it. Lord, what are you telling me? How do you want me to live? What do you want me to do? And then believe that he's told you by doing it. We're going to talk a lot more about that as we study what Paul has to say back in chapter 5. About this new lifestyle of grace and truth. But here he just enters in, or just causes us to enter into it by giving us the good news. Whereas we were cursed under the law, we are now blessed with faithful Abraham. And we receive the promise of the Spirit to walk in a brand new lifestyle. Let's thank God. Father God, as we come into your presence, we thank you. We praise you for the work that you've done on our behalf through your Son, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we recognize your death and resurrection for us to make us brand new persons. We want to believe it, Lord. Help our unbelief. We want to follow you and your Spirit in our lives. Teach us how to wait on you. Teach us. Lead us. Guide us according to your promise through your Spirit. that we might learn to walk a new lifestyle of grace and truth. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Appreciate y'all.